Welcome to our fourth and final episode of the Beyond Contemporary Art Series 2, presented by Avid Learning, along with the Goethe Institute, Max Müller Bhavan. Welcome. A quick recap of our series so far. Episode 1 probed established notions of art education and explored hybrid spaces like the artist colony, the artist residency, the artist run space, and the cafe. Episode 2 engaged with the question of political art, how it takes shape at the border between the art world and the larger public sphere. Episode 3 attempted to dissemble and examine the art archive, its elements, the impulses behind it, and its future. Today's episode, the fourth and final in our series, is titled The Relay Between Artists, Institutions, and Their Audiences, where we will engage with the perennial question of an audience for the arts and try to determine the optimal interplay between familiarity and criticality that can keep a cultural ecosystem vibrant. Leandra D'Souza, co-founder and curator of Art Oxygen, and Asad Lalji, curator of the Royal Opera House and co-curator of the Kalaghora Arts Festival Literature Section, are in conversation today with Ranjit Hoskote, curator, cultural theorist, pardon me, and jury member of the 56th Venice Biennale. Since no art form achieves completion until it has been received by an audience or a viewership, the beholder's share in the aesthetic process is a considerable one. Audiences form an important, if relatively unorganized, sector of cultural production. They function as recipients of artistic expression, as participants in institutions or occasions such as the museum, the gallery, the concert, and the festival, as contributors to an ongoing dialogue between the arts, and as stakeholders in cultural institutions. How do institutions create and sustain their audiences? How might institutions renew the experiences that they offer their audiences? Today, we turn the self-reflexive lens onto you, our audience, and probe your role in the arts. A little bit about our panel before we begin. Ranjit Hoskote is a cultural theorist, curator, poet, and a jury member of the 56th Venice Biennale. He has authored more than 25 books, including such monographs as The Complicit Observer, Reflections on the Art of Sudhir Patwardhan, Zini and Medigan, Compartment Da Subtile, and Atul Dodia. Since 1993, Ranjit has curated 30 exhibitions of contemporary art, including two monographic surveys of Atul Dodia, a lifetime retrospective of Jahangir Sabhawala, a historical survey of Indian abstraction, Nothing is Absolute, a show with Meli Gobai at the CSMBS, and a survey of 150 years of art by Parsi artists titled No Parsi is an Island with Nancy Adajania. Ranjit co-curated the 7th Gwangju Biennale in 2008 and was curator of India's first ever national pavilion at the Venice Biennale in 2011. Leandra D'Souza holds a master's in arts criticism from City University. Since 2009, she's run Art Oxygen, which is aimed at curating and producing art projects in public open spaces. Since 2010, she's organized Encounters, a public art festival dealing with issues affecting the everyday life of Mumbai. In 2013, she was invited to curate the participation of Indian and international artists at the biennial Haiyan Art Project at Haiyan Sa Temple in South Korea. In 2014, she received an award for culture and change bestowed by the Prince Claus Fund for Culture and Development, which enabled the production of Encounters 2015 at the iconic CST terminus. She also curates independently and has recently done so at the Sensorium 2015-16 Art Festival for the Suna Paranta Goa Center for the Arts, among others. Asad Lalji serves as the CEO of Avid Learning. He brings several years of global advertising, publishing, marketing, and business development experience. Prior to relocating to India in 2010 from New York, Asad worked for 14 years as one of the Mad Men advertising executives on New York's Madison Avenue. He has worked with McCann Erickson, Hill Holiday, and Kano Books USA. Under Asad's leadership at Avid, a wide variety of cultural programming was launched, including sustainable urbanism, regional culture, heritage preservation, and social media as a tool for connecting lives and communities. In 2016, Asad also co-curated the literature section of the Kalaghora Arts Festival, along with Ranjit Hoskote, and will continue to do so in 2017. In the past 6 years, Asad has brought Avid to the forefront of India's cultural hub by developing opportunities at some of the country's and region's largest cultural platforms. These include Art Dubai, the Jaipur Lit Fest, India Art Fair, Lit Live, Kalaghora Arts Festival, and India Art Fest. Asad has also partnered with leading institutions including the British Council, Oxford University, Columbia University's Studio X, TEDx, Toronto International Film Festival, NCPA, and the University of Mumbai. In 2016, he was appointed to serve as curator of the newly reopened and restored Royal Opera House, Mumbai, for which he has designed a robust curatorial program which goes over and above the performance arts and spans the breadth of art and culture. He holds a BA in Economics from St. Xavier's College in Mumbai and an MA in Global Marketing Communications from Emerson College in Boston. Welcome to our panelists, and now over to Ranjit.
Well, thank you for being here this evening, because it would have been a little ironic to have had a session devoted to audiences with no audience. That would have been cruel. But having said that, let me, what's that?
It's a good tone you said.
Indeed. But I'm going to also let you in to a little joke, which I can only make because you're here in goodly numbers, which is that about 3 days before any event that Asad and I are putting together, I get a call from Asad. He says, we only have 9 RSVPs. So then we go into a familiar routine of saying, you know, this is not much of an RSVP culture. People show up, this and that. But the reason I'm saying this is not to prove that he is nervous and I am calm. It's often the opposite. But it's just to say that for cultural organizers, particularly in our kind of situation, or really anywhere, you simply do not take the audience for granted. And the audience remains an entity to be reached out to be received in a certain way through the gesture of hospitality, and to be met in a space of encounter. And that, to me, is the basis for, I think, what we're going to be talking about today. And I really do want to thank Leandre and Asad for coming to the table and sharing their experiences and their insights. And I want to mark off the trope that we're using here, which is that I think of this relationship among artists, institutions, audiences, curators, organizers, as a relay. Because it isn't really a static diagram. We're looking here at a continuous production, if you will, of meaning, of value, of certain kinds of works. And this sort of constant exchange, and this constant unpredictable exchange, is really what lies at the heart of what we're talking about today. So I want to dwell in these opening remarks really on a couple of points that I want to make in relation to how audiences have in fact changed. There's a certain more classical way in which we imagine the arts to work, and there is a more experiential way in which they in fact work today. And I want to try and mark this off by recourse to two images. It's a little blurred, but I thought I'd begin with this Dutch engraving it's from the 18th century, of a demonstration of electricity. And it's not a very clear image, I'm afraid, from where you're sitting. But I think it captures neatly a certain kind of politics that informs the relationship between artwork or exhibition and audience. And here what we see is that there is a certain event which takes place, so to speak, on stage. It has a theatrical quality. And the audience is arranged around it in, if you will, attitudes of expectation, wonderment, bafflement, learning, even if you will. And there is a clear distinction between the provocation, the aesthetic prompt or provocation or event, and the recipients. And for a long, long time, I think this is the kind of model of viewing or of being an audience, how to be an audience, that's informed our, and it really shapes our reflexes and our instincts as an audience in many ways. Even I think in the questions we sometimes ask of artists or artworks or curators, what might this mean? How does this affect us? The notion that it is the artwork which will provide or withhold ways of seeing. And over against that, I'd place one of my favorite works of art, which is Ólafur Eliasson, the Icelandic artist Ólafur Eliasson's Weather Project. This is from the Turbine Hall of the Tate Modern from 2003. And to me, speaks of a completely different way of being an audience, where you actually are inside the artwork. You're immersed in it. You participate, as it were, in the making of the artwork. So as against the distinct event or aesthetic prompt towards which you are a beholder, here you are literally disoriented by the work. You are within the work. You are not at a distance. And your actions within the space of the work actually help produce it and to reproduce it in often unimagined ways. There's also, to pursue my particular obsession with the politics of viewing, in the earlier image, you'll see that there is a very clear hierarchy as to how the artwork stands in relation to the audience and how the audience is, in some sense, attending upon the artwork. Here, there's actually a far more relaxed, if you will, more leisurely, more receptive, more open kind of way of responding to the work. And I want us to keep this in mind because as we go along, we're going to be looking at questions of how institutions renew themselves, how they shape the field of experience that is viewing, what kinds of transitions get made when art exits the container model and moves to a more platform model, into social projects, into more interactive modes. So I'm going to ask you to just hold these images in mind. I also want to dwell briefly on the terminology we use, because we are often held captive by the language we use. Remember that I've, in these 5 or 6 minutes, been talking about audience and viewership. Now, each one of these words commits us to a kind of single sense usage. An audience, as the etymology suggests, is primarily one that listens. It refers to arts that have to do with sonic utterance or with music and so forth. Viewing, again, is something that seems primarily visual. How might we even transform our terminology? How might we reimagine an audience when so much of our work gets done in multi-sensory environments? So much of our art is something that appeals to various senses at the same time and is immersive. So that's another set of thoughts that I'd like us to keep in play. And also, in thinking about these questions of the assumptions, the axioms, if you will, some shared body of expectations and knowledge that holds artists and audiences together, I keep thinking of vexed questions like taste, or the canon, or competence. And this takes me back a long time ago to my aesthetics classes, where in many ways these things were taken as read. They were part of a certain classical way of thinking about art and art making. But how relevant would questions of taste be today? How does one define a canon? How does one think about aesthetic competence? What role do institutions play in negotiating these three now open questions? What kinds of phantoms of aesthetic preoccupations are we dealing with? So as we transit among different forms of art making, I find myself wondering what to do really with terms like russica, for instance, which implies a certain aesthetic competence and understanding of a particular theory of aesthetics, a notion of how art gets made, what is its ultimate value. What does one do with the notion of the connoisseur, which also emerges from a very particular social setting? It emerges from a certain elite understanding of art and the understanding of art as accomplishments. Does this mean anything? What does a term like aesthete mean? How does one redesignate the audience for art? What might we expect of audiences? And so that's that in a more democratic paradigm. And another set of questions that I think about is precisely what was indicated in the note, which is, in what way can audiences be effective stakeholders in institutions? Would institutions invite that kind of participation as they continue their cycles of programming and pursue their own agendas? Which is why I thought we'd throw into play this binary between familiarity and criticality. I think there are ways in which, whether it's a museum or a gallery, an opera house, a literary festival, there is constantly a push-pull between things that might be familiar to audiences and things that are more critical, more edgy, that push people away from, take people away from what they're used to. And how does one actually take one's institutional destiny forward in negotiating these? At the same time, there might well be another kind of situation where the audience is far ahead of the institution. The institution may want to reproduce what is familiar and canonical to it as a notion of what truly matters, whilst the audience, particularly audiences that might be transcultural, that might be younger, that might just have very different cultural starting points, the audience might want something far more critical, and institutions might fail audiences. So this can cut both ways. So that's another set of thoughts that I'm going to ask both Leandra and Asad and all of you to sort of dwell on. And basically, it's with these framing thoughts that I would now invite Leandra first to make her presentation, after which we'll hear from Asad, and then we'll all come up together and have a conversation. Leandra, would you?
Thank you, Ranjit, and Avid also for the introduction and also for inviting me to be part of this discussion to share some of the learnings accumulated through our practice. Art Oxygen, known as Art02, is a public art initiative that is started by myself and my partner Claudio Maffioletti in 2009. We produce works in public spaces or in urban context with the idea to provide access to contemporary art, but also to try to renew practice itself by placing it in contexts that are always changing, where the work might receive continuous feedback from the context in which it finds itself. We started our first project in 2010, which began as an experiment to see what would happen when we shifted the process of creativity and production from the studio into an urban framework. We also wanted to test the role of art to see whether it could trigger any kind of creativity or criticality. However, when we shifted this process from the inside to the outside, we realized that our playing field got a lot wider. The work was no longer limited to just the materiality of the object, but it became a series of processes that involved permissions on site, spending extensive time to understand who are using that space, who live there, understanding the power structures there. So our work tries to interrogate the nature of the public intended as geographical, social, and also political. The first experiment we did was called encounters. By definition, an encounter is both a meeting and a clash. And we felt that this reflected the dichotomous nature of Bombay City, where we started to do these temporary, ephemeral interventions and actions. And I'll just take you very quickly through some of the works. So it is not often that we encounter a marriage procession where the artist is dressed as a construction worker who collects as dowry soil from different parts of the city. Or a superhero on a bulldozer that travels to different parts of Bombay certifying builders for beautifying the city. It is not often that we see flags on top of forts, each carrying in red thread the most ordinary creatures. We don't also see on a beachfront letters of love or loss inscribed with salt, the life of the letter dependent on geological conditions or ocean currents that eventually wash it away. Or an artist that looks for hidden water bodies using techniques of divination. How often are we confronted with strange requests by artists asking us to share personal belongings that would become part of a city archive? Or a weather station that monitors snow in a tropical climate? Or even how often have we stepped on works that take us on a journey through a mountain, acting as a navigator between life and the afterlife? All of these works have some relevance to the site in which they were located. They're all concerned with the moment, the now. In each of these projects, the artists have brought their ideas and their practices to sites that you would not imagine to encounter them. And it is a dislocation from, and in this kind of dislocation from the private studio, the gallery, to the outside open space, the artists begin to adopt a more flexible approach to the sites which they intervene in through a mediated process that is aimed at establishing a relationship with both the site and also those who inhabit it. What are the implications of this on the artist, the work, and the viewer? Is the distance between them reduced? Is this relationship even necessary? And if so, are we saying that a work is never complete unless it is validated by the viewer? Artitude's approach uses strategies that initiate from a process of dialogue and engagement between the city and the artist, where the latter begins to act as a facilitator and starts to negotiate the work according to different inputs that they are receiving. And in this way, we try to broaden or open up the artistic process, allowing it to be affected by external stimuli, and trying to stretch also the aesthetic paradigm, where it starts to get affected by the behavior of others, the work they do, their lives, their habits. And in this way, we keep trying to challenge the way or the premise on which art is being made and experienced. In terms of experience also, we are trying to expand it from being merely perceptive to also now relational. And the relational aspect also in our practice becomes quite crucial because artists are starting to probe into the human condition and trying to question or recognize the value of this potential. We are often asked, how does a common man in a public space who might have no knowledge of art experience the work? How does he receive it? A city like Bombay, by its nature, is quite curious. You place anything out of the ordinary and people will gather around and they will ask questions. I think the question is not really how people receive the work, but rather how the work becomes a starting point for something far more profound. We are concerned more with the reciprocal kind of exchange and how the work might activate a renewed relational exchange. But the relational, we're not talking about just in terms of the physical, but also in terms of an exchange between concepts, skills, capacities, ideas. The common man, actually, from our different projects, we've realized is quite bold and they're very opinionated. They will decide whether to be part of a work, whether to accept it, and on their own terms. And sometimes they will even refuse it. I will be showing you quickly just four projects to illustrate how this same model of working we try to replicate in different contexts and situations, but all the time we keep trying to test the role of art, experiment with its forms, try to inverse the mode of production, question hierarchies between the artist and the audience, and all the time trying to allow for multiple opinions, readings, and outcomes. Tracing a Disappearance is a mapping exercise that was done by Prajakta Potnis in 2011. Prajakta wanted to intervene at this lake in Thana called the Siddheshwar Talao. She wanted to show how this natural resource in this area had been compromised to just becoming a small little pond because of either human encroachment or urban development. So she uses as the form a very, like the most basic form, which is the line, and she pours chalk powder to mark out or retrace the original contours of this water body. With the chalk, she goes over, she goes on the street, she goes over flyovers, under bridges, around buildings, and then she comes to a slum settlement. And here the work begins to get quite hostile. The people who were living there refused to believe that this was an artistic intervention. And perhaps the thing with that form, even though it was just a line, even though it was temporary, and even though Prajakta's intentions was to restore the lake to its former scale, even for a moment, it met with this underlying fear, probably of the inhabitants of being evicted, and that led to us forcibly having to stop the work and vacate the premise. Happy Journey is a participatory piece by an artist from Korea called Kyung-woo Chun. Kyung-woo inhabits the VT station for 2 weeks, during which he places in a sculptural form a shape that has the form of the station, but it also functions as a bench. So people can come, they can sit there while they're waiting for their trains, and while they're, during this time, the artist starts to speak to them and ask them really strangely whether they will share personal objects with the artist that would then become part of this collective piece. In a lot of Kyung-woo's works, he kind of provokes the viewer, but also exposes a kind of vulnerability. But at the same time, he kind of shifts the positioning where it is the viewer who will decide whether or not to intentionally be part of this work. The artist poses an additional challenge where when he was talking to commuters, he didn't want them to respond immediately and participate in the work, but he wanted them to go to where they were headed and then think about whether they wanted to be a part or share a part of themselves with the artist and then return with the object. And each object that is then collected is then placed, is then tagged with the name of the person and the distance it traveled to get there. And for those who ended up not participating, and they're just left with, I suppose, the memory of this strange encounter and this relationship that was established, even if it was just for a temporary time. Peeling the Onion in the Nizamuddin Basti is a process-based community project done by Tushar Jog in New Delhi. The Humayun's tomb is located in the Nizamuddin Basti that is undergoing a series of restoration projects over several years. Tushar presented, he presents just a cartographic outline of the Basti, and he invites different groups of people. So people who work there, people who live there, the chiselers, gardeners, landscapers, students, the Aga Khan Foundation, the pilgrims, to mark out spaces that have specific function. So places where they hunt for pigeons is called a leisure space, where Monday markets are held is called It's called shopping centers. And once these first spaces are identified, he involves women to cut out these maps using a Sanji technique, but he inverses the structural elements of this form where the maps then appear to be peeled off. And each peel is then coded and superimposed one on top of each other in glass containers so that the maps appear like they are floating or intersecting. Now, Tushar's process is that he starts off with an initial idea and sets a test field, and then this experiment takes off. So we always know what the starting point is. We never know what the outcome of that of the piece will be. And here is an example of where the work, I mean, the artist is acting more as a facilitator, and the work is actually done, or there are different the stakeholders of the project become the people who are living, working there, or passing by also. And finally, Essence Function is a piece done by a Spanish artist, Fernando Garcia Dori, in a monastery in Korea. Fernando is interested in intersections between Eastern and Western philosophies, and he creates situations where both are challenged and confronted. Essence in the, I mean, the piece, the title of the piece refers to essence, which is the core of the human mind, and function refers to our thoughts, words, and actions. The work basically takes the form of a temporary structure inside which he starts to build a herbarium formed out of plants and local herbs that he collects from the nearby village, markets, or mountain. And then he activates the site by inviting monks, curators, artists, pilgrims to come and share their knowledge of these plants. So people start to share either the scientific properties of these plants, the cultural, social, religious function in their daily culture. And then the artist, together with the monks, starts to catalog these the information that he is receiving using different methods of pressing, drying, bottling, transcribing with calligraphy, and turning this piece into a storehouse of like a storehouse of different kinds of narratives and experiences. And that's it. Yeah.
Thank you guys for coming. Thank you, Ranjit, for asking me to be part of an Avid panel. It's kind of, I was very reticent to accept because it's like, you know, having a sponsor come up and tell his life story. But I will try not to talk about Avid, which is going to be very difficult, as Ranjit asked me to talk about two specific cases. One is the Royal Opera House and the other is Kala Ghora. But I'll have to use some references from Avid, so you'll have to excuse me for that. You know, it's interesting that I'm doing this talk, this particular talk, during the Beyond Contemporary Art series. I don't know if Ranjit remembers this, but the impetus for this series started off a few years ago when Avid and Ranjit used to work on something called the India Art Festival, and we had our speakers forum out there. And there was a pure disconnect between the content and the audience. And we struggled for 1 year, struggled for the second year, and then we said, you know, we should just take this out of this environment and create a neutral environment, not in a gallery setting, not in a show, and build our audience from there. And it's come full circle, now I'm talking about it. So the question or the topic he gave me was building new audiences, which I will address today. And as, again, alluded earlier, I'll talk about the Royal Opera House and Kala Ghora. I'm going to flip through these. So some of you know that the Opera House reopened last month after being shut for 23 years. Some of you may have had the pleasure of being there. Some of them may have come for the opening, some of them have passed by. Otherwise, I encourage you all to come and experience that wonderful space. The Opera House was built in 1911, actually inaugurated in 1911, built in 1908, and inaugurated by King George V. It has been restored to its original glory by Abba Narayan Lamba, the conservation architect, and features a 574-seater. I'm just going to give you a little brief on it. Auditorium with the state-of-the-art technological upgrades, by still maintaining its old-world charm and all, and how the building was originally created. But again, we have to, you know, bring in modern-day needs, which is air conditioning and sound, which was accommodated to bring this building to its present state. Your friends are leaving with my presentation. That's not fair. I'm just kidding. I'm doing your public event, huh, by the way. Stay. Just kidding. I'm just going to share a few pictures and then go into some thought process, what we are going to be using to build new audiences for the Royal Opera House. I thought I'd just share the images first so you get to see how the space looks, in case you all haven't been there. The approach to building new audiences is the same, which we're going to be using for the Royal Opera House, and which I think many people within the arts and culture use. And I'll take you through a few of them. You do have your existing ecosystem. When you have a space, you need talent, you need practitioners, you need artists, you need performers to come there, and how do you get them? You invite them in, alternately you partner. And partnerships are a key way we built audiences. I know Leandro has done lots of partnerships also for Art Oxygen, but we collaborate with everyone, that's rule of thumb, including the international partners like the cultural institutions and the high commissions. That's one area of building your ecosystem. The other is creating original programming. Again, from the Avid angle, we have collaborated with everybody. In fact, this talk out here is a collaboration with the Max Mueller. So similarly for the Opera House, we are planning such an approach. Again, a way of building audiences is obviously having smart curation, which is obviously something we are working on. But, I think Ranjit mentioned my paranoia call, which I give everybody 3 days before an event, the Monday before, to be honest, is I look at numbers. Now, just because you're creating a program doesn't mean that people are going to come. I was away from India for many years, 16 years, and I came back. Bombay was Mumbai. I thought, okay, it was a confusing place. And in the 6 years I've been back, it's become even more confusing. But the one good thing I can say, and I've been saying this regularly, is the cultural consumption of Mumbai, at least I can talk for Mumbai, has increased drastically. Every day you have about 6 or 7 really interesting things to do. There are options, which I believe weren't there before. And if you open any newspaper, I mean, not that too many people read them anymore, but you open the Mumbai Mirror, open the HT Cafe, you open the listing section, there's a full page devoted to these, and publications won't put them, invest, you know, valuable, valuable ad space to list these if people weren't interested in them. So I think the cultural consumption of the city is increasing. There are lots of people doing lots of things. But to build an audience, you have to be, you have to give them something different, something unique. And I'm not from the arts and culture background. I'm from the advertising background. I'm from the marketing background. I've always treated the arts as also with that sensibility. You have to look at it from research, like what do people want? You have to optimize. It's like a business. You can't just do a project. Ranjit mentioned that sometimes institutions are lagging behind what their audiences want. You ask, you ask people what they're looking for, and you level set, and you create programs. Another whole area of building audiences is through your outreach campaigns and social media. I think that has become an integral part of building audiences today. Ranjit had mentioned in his original thing, it's how your audiences are reacting with your work, but now they're reacting back and they're communicating with you. So at every point of time, I hope somebody is tweeting and pushing out this wonderful talk you're attending, but it's a live two-way, 24/7 dialogue you're having with your audience, and you're as good as your last performance. One bad tweet on social media, you have to go and do damage control. So it's also a risky double-edged sword that you have. For Opera House, and I'll take you through the thinking in the Kalagora example. In the Opera House, what we did was for the opening weekend, just to see how we are building audiences. As many of you all knew, the Opera House opened on the 20th of October with the Mami Film Festival. It was a fitting tribute to its film legacy, but it's the Opera House. So I actually fought really hard that, you can't reopen the Opera House after 23 years and have a film festival. So we curated a small operatic performance. That's Patricia Rosario and her husband, Mark Troop. That handsome gentleman is me. And we created a small performance, not very long, an homage to the Royal Opera House, which was very well received. And then, the following week, we opened it up to the music fraternity. Again, this is, again, audience building, because you're reopening a closed space. Everyone's excited about this wonderful, beautiful space opening. I mean, if you started with a film festival and ended right there, they're going to wonder what the hell you're doing, because you have that one shot to get people in. But that said, Opera House is just level setting, getting a couple of things finished. But we have a robust plan. There is a couple of very big music performances planned in the month of December. The Neem Rana Foundation is doing an opera on the 4th of December. And you can just stay tuned, and we can fill you in more of the programming. I'll just talk about Kalagora, which will make more sense, because that I couldn't go into details because it's only a month old, so I can kind of explain to you how do you build audiences in the right way. Avid has been involved with the Kalagora Arts Festival since 2011, and we used to create or curate a small program within Kalagora called Avid Spectrum that was always integrated within Kalagora, but it was like a festival within a festival. 3 years down the line, I didn't see the point of doing it because there was so much cool programming anyway happening during Kalagora. So we were invited in by Ranjit and Brinda to come and be part of the literature vertical, and Avid started curating the writing workshops. And then this year, so we started obviously working in 2015, Ranjit and Brinda invited me to come in and co-curate the section with him. You may recognize those handsome gentlemen downstairs. So what did we do different? And I'll take you through some of that, which helps in audience building. This was a literature component in a large, arts festival. Now, we wanted to increase footfalls, build audiences, but not alienate our core group, which is very important. You have to be true to what you are. But on the flip side, we wanted to build a younger audience. We wanted to encourage a different segment to come in. So we did a couple of cool things, which I will walk you through. We did it through collaborations and partnerships, which is rule number one, created unique IPs. I will take you through that example also. And, leveraged our international cultural relationships with consulates and associations by inviting in international speakers, because you give people the opportunity to experience voices they haven't experienced before. For example, there's just before Kalagora, you have the Jaipur Lit Fest, where everybody from the world comes and pays pilgrimage to the Pink City. So what we did was we consciously went after many of these voices who were coming to India to try and present them to the Bombay audience. Obviously, digital was a big component of how we tried to build awareness and also create numbers. Is Mustansir here? I know he was coming. So we curated, it's again the programming you do. So we tried to create very different kind of programming from workshops. We rebranded, repositioned them as masterclasses, and just some pictures of them. And we created unique programs. We had Omar Musa from Australia, who did a poetry slam dunk workshop. We had the Molly Crabapple. She's the lady who was catching. She's from New York, and I think called her the Lady Gaga of literature. We created, Mustansir was there. He did a really cool workshop on describing Bombay and 101 objects. So we changed the programming and made it very different, something that one would not expect the Kalagora Lit Fest. Obviously, the salons and panels were curated very smartly. We had about 150 authors. We had 63 panels across two venues. And we had authors from Australia, Canada, Denmark, UK, all over. We had the Tark team, represented now by Korshed out here, and the Avid team, work very, very closely to kind of make sure that we had a good mix across the genres. These are two interesting examples that we use to generate new audiences. We created a pop-up library through which we crowdsourced. We had about 5,000 books that we received through donations, all pushed out through social media. We asked every author to give us two copies of their book signed, and we created this very grassroots little pop-up library within David Sassoon's garden. The idea, we called it Bookstellation, and the idea was we wanted people to come and interact with books. We wanted people to touch a book, essentially. You know, and we had, and it was very successful because people were there, they were interacting with books, they were spending time there, they were reading, they found their favorite books. And then we used all these books and donated them to libraries that needed them. In fact, even our little kitschy bookshelves were donated to a Remand home, which still is used as a bookshop there. So this next year, for 2017, also we are keeping this concept going, only we're going to evolve our design from the mango crates to something that hopefully Mustansir and his team at JJ are going to help us design. Another element which we brought in, again, to engage the younger audience and to build a bigger audience, was we did something called Sassoon Legacy, which was, and I'll, these images may not be the greatest, but we wanted to tell, we obviously had access to this passage. For most of you who have been to David Sassoon, it's one of the most beautiful buildings in Bombay. It's right around the corner, so if you haven't, go walk across. You might find these panels, actually you will find these panels still hanging out there. 10 months later, yellow, but still it's there. But we wanted to kind of educate or reach out to the younger audiences and tell them the history of David Sassoon, the library. Kalagora, the statue, was actually commissioned by David Sassoon's son. And, you know, tie it back to literature. Now, how do we talk to the young? How do we try and reach out to that new audience? And we did it through this very grassroots. We're not saying that this is a work of art, something highbrow. We just illustrated a story, and we did the whole concept through hashtags and called outs. And again, you know, we spoke to them in the language they're used to listening to. And it was extremely successful, and obviously pushed this out through social media. And in fact, I think somebody in my team was telling me now schools had actually made this part of a trivia walk, and they asked people questions based on what this thing was. So it's a real simple idea, but you know, if you want to expand your audience, you can come up with things like this. So for 2017, we've already come up. We're going to look at the publishing legacy of Bombay, and we're looking at it across four languages: Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati, and English. So our four panels will be devoted to that, and so you know, we'll hopefully get a multilingual audience as the step. You might recognize that handsome gentleman again. But you know, digital plays a very important part of building audiences, especially in today. And social media cannot be replaced. It has to be an integral part of your outreach. So for Kalagora, we did a couple of campaigns. We had a campaign called Voice Virus, and which we had tweet chats with authors, and we had a pretty aggressive social media campaign that we actually set for the literature vertical and actually for part of the Kalagora overarching brand. That's just an interesting image. So, you know, I'd mentioned earlier that creating IPs, which is an interesting way of reaching newer audiences. See, Kalagora happens once a year. It's been there for 17, 18 years. It's a fantastic, iconic brand. But then for the year, nothing happens. So Mr. Mukherjee of the CSMVS, Brinda and Manik, asked Avid to actually create a monthly series. So what we did was we started a monthly series, which we call the Kalagora Arts Festival Series 16-17, where every month we take a vertical from Kalagora and we curate an interesting panel around it. So the first one was, you know, Heritage Goes Pop, where we obviously, it needed to say what it is about. The next month we talked about the food maps of Mumbai. I wanted to keep it more specific to Mumbai. Then, you know, in association with Mami, when Mami was launching, we did cinema maps of Mumbai, and we have put Anupama Chopra on the panel, again, tying it in. Again, this is partnerships, collaborations. The previous one, you may have seen that we worked with the Italian consulate to get an Italian designer who was here for the design triennale. The last one we had was on art maps, and I won't go into details, but on art maps. And then we have a monthly series, and we're covering every genre as a way of keeping the Kalagora brand top of mind for people and them not forgetting it. So that's another way which I think is a smart way of audience building. I think have gone through my time. So to be very honest, I prepared this presentation for something else, and I prepared it on Monday of last week. At that point of time, we thought people listened to him, but they didn't, so Trump won. So this is my thank you for listening slide. But I couldn't remove it.
Thank you both. And I can get back to... Thank you for both your presentations. It's really... Now, I was fascinated, and I know many of you would have been too, because there were two very, very distinctive perspectives. I think, in to characterize briefly, I think Leandri's practice has a great deal to do with the notion of the expanded studio. The way in which a more classical studio practice moves out into relatively untested public and social spaces, invites unpredictable interactions, and also, which I want to ask you more about, takes advantage of a whole range of possibilities, happenstance, invitations, and allows for the reinvention of practice in a certain way. And Asad, with you, I was interested to look at the way in which you worked with pre-existing institutions, an opera house in one case and a festival in another, each with its strongly sedimented, if you will, heritage, its trajectory, a set of subliminal associations, perceptions of it, and then how do you tweak and work with that? So I want to maybe, let me begin with you, Leandri. I just want to draw you out a little more on the itinerant nature of your work, in the sense that it's a transcultural practice. I mean, if you look at one dimension of your work, it seems to be very Bombay-centric, and it is quite anchored. But on the other hand, there was also the work in Korea, you've worked in Italy, you've worked in a variety of places. And I sometimes think, and this is true of most of our lives, I keep, at the back of my mind, I keep thinking of Myeon Kwon, the idea of, you know, one place after another, and how it's possible that some of us might fall into a pattern of simply recrafting ourselves and our practice to suit the next residency, the next invitation, the next biennial. So could I draw you out a little bit on how you deal with this factor of itinerancy and circulation, and yet retain certain ongoing persistent preoccupations?
Well, I'll just really tell you about how we started. I mean, there are two or three preoccupations that we have that we keep testing, and through this kind of study, whether it then is realized in the context of Bombay or in New Delhi or in other cities. One of them, and we do this by literally trying to shift from a studio practice the work, but really, it's not just a shift, it's really about starting from the site in which we're working. So whether it is a monastery or whether it's a heritage site or the VT station for that matter. So I think what the artists are trying to do in many of the projects is trying to understand the space, and trying to also, by bringing in their practices there, trying to open up questions of whether or trying to change people's experience of the space itself. And along with this, we are looking at what is happening to the artist. Are they starting to use different strategies in their works? So it's no longer just about placing an object. So it's not about thinking about a work from the studio and then having that place somewhere else, but it's really about how the artist starts to use different strategies, archival, ethnographic, journalistic, researcher, water divination, whatever you might call it. Secondly, also, how the artist is the artist maintaining a kind of balance between the aesthetics and the ethics of the work. And thirdly, how do we find value in such work, where many times the form itself becomes intangible, the form itself sometimes gets reduced to an archival document. So these are some of the preoccupations, and we started with using Bombay as a test field from where we keep trying to see if this hypothesis can be verified or not. And at the same time, we're also looking at what is happening with the shift in the work and with the newest or different strategies that artists might be using to realize their work or to verify the relevance of their work in these spaces. What is happening also to the audience? And how are they engaging in different levels with the work? How is that either changing the experience of the space? How are they getting more actively involved in the work? Is there really an exchange that is happening in terms of different skills, concepts, etc.? So this is really, it's really a study that we just keep.
Something that you said, Leandre, changing people's experience of the space, which was part of one of the first of the three or four hypotheses that you test out. I want to take that thought with me to you, Asad, and to ask you about how you've managed a balance between, I'm going to use this amazing trope from this image from Marx, where he says something to the effect that the tradition of all the dead generations weighs like a nightmare in the brain of the living. I mean, that's a very jaundiced view of tradition and inheritance. But there's a way in which there's a certain momentum that you inherit when you come into an institution. What sorts of forms of diplomacy would you deploy, or not, to either take that forward or to mark a radical shift? Because, I mean, the Opera House has had its wonderful history, but some of that history is now, it's crystallized within particular historical narratives. You have a new audience, it's a new moment. How do you, what are your thoughts on how you manage the ratio between inheritance and what this needs to do now?
You know, with the... So with the Opera House as an example, it's actually pretty easy because, you know, the it's a privately owned institution, which changes things a lot. It's owned by the Gondal family, and the Maharaja and Maharani of Gondal have, it was their desire to bring the space back to its origin. So, you know, before it shut down, the Opera House was a movie theater. They made every effort not to put a screen in there. So that kind of sets the tone already for me, like it's not going to be a movie theater again. Ironically, it started with the launch of the Mami Festival, but there wasn't anything screened there. Tonight, there's the Russian Film Festival happening there. But since it's a performing arts space, and it gives me a bigger, a blanker canvas, sure, I mean, history, heritage is all very important, but in a city like Mumbai, where spaces are so short, and I think it opens up the box a little more. If we were in a place, say, like New York, where you do have many performing arts spaces, then one would curate closer to what the venue stands for. And I've always believed that, you know, I love juxtapositioning the old with the new, and I've been quoted a couple of times. I mean, I'd love to do a TEDx talk at the Opera House. I've already invited Inc. and TEDx to come in and see the space. But I'd love to talk about new media and technology in that space. I think it fits beautifully. Again, it's a perfect example of the old with the new. You're sitting in a over 100-year-old building that's been impeccably restored. Some of the murals have been restored by Anupam, who's sitting at the back. You know, it's got state-of-the-art technology and air conditioning, which is, you know, it kind of answers it for itself. And again, you know, I feel, you know, by judging, at least working on Avid has given me a good gut feel of what people are looking for. So you also curate basically what people want. It's lovely to curate a subject that I'm interested in. If there are four people sitting in the audience, I mean, it's, you know, kind of a waste of time. So I think keeping it broader, keeping it relevant, keeping it interesting is the way I would approach the legacy I've inherited and rechange it. Sorry.
You are such a diplomat. But Leandre, I'm going to take some of those thoughts now to you. I remain preoccupied with ideas of institutional memory. And when it's a festival, which I'll come to next, or an itinerant platform that is constantly in a state of reinvention, what sort of institutional memory would Art Oxygen develop? And whose institutional memory is it? Because I can imagine that for all the artists who've been part of this, there is a certain ongoing sense of belonging within this project. There's a whole set of sensations and learnings and so on. But because the audience is so, in that sense, variable or mobile or distributed, would you have any thoughts on how, I mean, is there any consistency in terms of the connection between the project and its different audiences? Does that continue beyond the life cycle of an individual project?
Actually, I realized that I didn't finish answering the rest of your question, because you, the first question you asked me about, you had mentioned something about the biennial, and in fact, it was the last Venice Biennial in which one of, I think it was a Swiss artist that constructed a mosque, exactly. And it was shut down after some time, I think, because it was, I don't know, I guess there were too many people that were collecting there and meditating. And so artists are bringing in these, I don't know, it's, the work itself might not have, the intention was not political, it became hostile, if you want to call it that. So I think what we're trying to do is also maybe create a space where artists can bring in their concerns and a really open field where there, you know, there's no established meaning, or where the works can really take different forms, where they in some cases also where they evolve over time. And also in the case of different artists, we tend to many times work with the same artist year after year, because we feel that the work itself needs time to evolve, and it's a vulnerable space working in any public space, whether it is in a biennial setting or the city of Bombay, VT station, or wherever it is. It is a vulnerable space, and I think I mean, but basically that's what I wanted to say. That I don't know if I answered the question at all, but yeah.
I just want to draw you out a little more on that, actually, because I know the work well, and had a long conversation with the artist, Swiss artist, but it was the Pavilion of Iceland. And he transformed a disused church into a mosque. But it kind of raised a whole series of ethical questions. I mean, we were talking a little earlier about the balance between aesthetics and ethics, and I felt strongly at the time that although I empathized with the project, it had not fully considered what was involved.
Exactly.
Even for the people who are going to be invited into the space. Yeah.
So maybe in that case, I don't know, if the artist maybe would have approached it differently, would have, got, the people who are living there involved, the people living there involved in the work, where he might have maybe reversed the process, the outcome and the end might have been different. And this is also why it's important also to see over time how the artistic process starts to open up, and artists start to use different ways of working that is not just artistic in their practice. And that is why we keep sort of intruding into this everyday life and putting our noses outside and trying to create this dialogue between the inside and the outside, really. Yeah.
And so your role as a curator would encompass a whole series of different mediations. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes, in the sense that it's actually really tough to work in the public space because I mean, curatorially, we have an idea, and the artists are working for months on their work, actually almost a year, and then, it always happens where at different sites, we may not even get the permissions to do the work, but then the artist always ready to even go underground and guerrilla and just go out and do the work, because without it, the work will not happen. So yes, as a curator, but even as artists, we're all functioning maybe as we become, working with bureaucrats, trying to get permissions at site, trying to understand weather conditions at spaces, trying to understand how the work will survive at that site, the artists themselves. So it's a continuous really dialogue and conversation between the site, the people who are using it, the artists, the work, and it's a relationship that we try to establish and we try to keep, because the city itself is a shared space, and we appreciate these relationships we have with either whatever civic bodies or officials at different institutions, and hopefully also getting them to recognize the value culturally of such kinds of works in these spaces.
I said I'm going to draw you out also on your evolving role as a curator in different kinds of contexts. I mean, how do you, and also something you left unsaid and was left unsaid also in your bio, I think. You've actually had a long and deep connection with discourse in print. You've had connections with Marg, and that's been a very particular case. So do you want to talk a little bit about your different engagements with the print medium, with a festival, with your new role, and speaking particularly to the question of how you develop formats, because in this question of building or activating an audience, I think one of the great challenges for all of us is also how to develop new formats of engagement and not fall into well-established ways.
The publishing angle, I have a old client sitting here. I actually just fell into publishing. At one point of time, I answered an ad on monster.com. It was a publisher who needed some help with marketing. And, you know, I was in New York at that time. I was freelancing. I had lots of really cool projects I was working on. So I took it on, and I didn't know anything about publishing. And I bought a book, 101 on how to publish. And I read it. And, you know, put two and two together and learned how to distribute and learned the trade. And it's very different compared to India, I think. But you know, I got involved in publishing for a short while, and I obviously had my connections with India. And when I started distributing for a large French publisher internationally, I came to India and one of my visits, and I met publishers like India Book House and Marg, and I helped set up Marg's international distribution. I worked with Padmini on a couple of projects. But again, I think my involvement with publishing was more from a business development angle, but I was also very interested in the topics. I worked mostly on illustrated books. With Padmini, we had done the 101 on contemporary art. With Amrita, helped launch that. With Marg, there were many titles. So, you know, it was a general interest of mine, and I went back, and no one makes money in publishing, so I went back to advertising, which I knew well. But I kept, a 1 foot in publishing. It just happened that, you know, people needed help. I said, yes, it's something I could do. So it wasn't an integral part of what I did, but something I understood and I feel, you know, a connection to. And I would actually bridge, because I think if you can manage to bridge over a couple of elements that you work on and or circles your lives revolve around in. And I remember when I was heading the B2B business for Verizon Wireless, which is was the largest ad spend in the country, I was in London just walking around London Book Show. I found a wonderful book called Bow, Shake Hands, or Kiss, Global Business Practices in a Global World, by an author called Terry Morrison. I thought that was quite fascinating. And at that point of time, Apple was about to launch its iPhone with Verizon, and I was working on with Blackberry, with RIM, BlackBerry, and I said, oh, that's a cool idea. So I got the CTO, the chief technology officers, to attend a presentation by this lady. And, you know, it was a great experiential event, but I tied publishing into advertising, which is just what I believe. You can always cross over things and evolve things. So that was my publishing life. And when I came back to India, I decided to close that chapter, no pun intended. But the way I curate and the way I look at things is, you know, I first of all think of myself as a consumer of the arts. What would I like to go to? It sounds very self-centered, but, you know, there are lots of cool things happening. There are a lot of interesting things happening. And at Avid Art, at least the way we program, is if somebody else is doing it, we don't need to, because there's great stuff. A lot of people are doing it. Everyone tells me, why aren't you doing stuff in Bandra? It's so, it's such a nice area and goes on. I said, everyone's doing what they need to. You can't be everything to everyone. You have to just choose your niche and own it. And I love to keep changing formats because I think it's interesting. I think you avoid audience fatigue. You do have a loyal audience base who comes to many of your programs like yourselves out here. And it's the opportunity to give them also alternate formats. And again, you can't keep changing things drastically every day. I mean, you start, you do this format. Now, as we were speaking, this is the second edition of Beyond Contemporary Art. We don't know what we'll do to the third edition if we do it. Would we put it in this format? We've experimented with roundtables off late and pushing out stuff digitally. Or maybe we'll just do Facebook Live and have all our sessions there. We don't know. So I think as we go along, as the topic suits it, as what's happening, in the environment, because there are, you know, this is the literature season, there are literature festival after festival. So I think people now to do a book launch or a book event at this point of time would not make sense from a programming standpoint for me, because there's lots of cool stuff happening in Bombay already. So we are focusing more on arts, on the visual arts actually. So just using basically common sense, I think, is the approach I go with.
Again, I want to make this shift between, say, Asad, who you tend to work with cultural products or productions that are in place, and then sort of move them towards an audience or develop a kind of atmosphere around them. But what seems to be happening often in your case, Leander, in your practice, is that, following Burio, in a way, it's in the relationality of the artistic practice that something new or often sometimes unfamiliar or unrecognizable is produced. So I'm going to come back to that question of the audience. Say the commuters at VT in Kyung Hoo's project, or the people who came to the Korean temple and, you know, it briefly became a kind of exhibitionary zone. I still tend to think about what place these experiences might have in the life of the mind of the audience, particularly, I mean, in the case of the commuters. I mean, it's a kind of surprise in a certain kind of life. But does that ever translate as coming back into a space where they can receive more of this, engage with it? Often these interventions do not map onto people's conventional notions of what art is. So is there a kind of pedagogical element also involved in, you know, I mean, how do you relate these practices to the lives of the sometimes involuntary viewers?
It depends. It depends on the work, first of all, and what the artist is bringing to the space and what kind of engagement he wants. Now, in Kyung Woo's case, he was playing with the element of time in a place where you don't have any time. And he was also trying to stretch it to the point where he was willing to risk loss or failure of that work, because he didn't want people to participate immediately in the work. He wanted really them to think about this encounter and this really strange thing of having an artist come and sit down, spend time with them, speak to them about their day, about how bad or how good it was. And So from the point of view of the audience, I think in that specific work, the outcome was really about how people actually came back. So they were consciously, they might have been thinking about this, what happened and what object they could give the artist that would become part of this sculpture. So that is one level, I think, of participation. And then another work might push it a bit further. So someone like Tushar or Fernando is really trying to see whether this exchange can be generated. So while one is just trying to provoke a reaction which might turn into physical participation, another is really trying to see if this kind of democratic exchange can be generated and whether there can be this exchange of roles, whether a carpenter does not necessarily have to remain a carpenter, but he might also take part in a placemaking project. And that is a different kind of involvement and engagement. In Fernando's case, it's a sharing of knowledge. So he's looking at how knowledge is generated or altered or shared, and how this sharing of the functions of these plants become, I mean, they all have the same value level, whether it is someone who is, I don't know, a botanist, so sharing, you know, the scientific properties, or someone who is a doctor, or someone who is a monk, or just a cook, sharing, you know, how they use these herbs. So it's really trying to bring together people who would not normally engage with each other, and the artist also who would not normally engage with different kinds of people. So it's really trying to collide, and that's why we call it the encounter. And what kind of eruptions happened with this meeting? Yeah.
So one more question for me before we open this up, and I'm sure many of you have questions too. Asad, there's a figure that has recurred in what you've said, the figure of the cultural consumer. So I just want to ask both of you how you would construe such a figure, or let me begin with you, and then I'll ask Leandra her views on this. How do you map, what forms of research bring you to what this cultural consumer is?
You know, it's not unidimensional. I mean, it's a subset, it's a target. I think, you know, at AVID, we don't program for children anymore, but we used to. When you look at children as a segment, it's a different audience. That includes the parents, because they're the ones who bring the kids there. But from an AVID perspective, or I think for an opera house perspective, would be kind of the similar audience. We're looking at people, if you're looking at a mindset, it's the mindset of people who are trying to learn something. Hence our hashtag, you know, learning never stops. If people are of that inclination, you know, you find people here from diverse walks of life. And I see a lot of regular people, and I'm sure they come, they're all groupies of Mr. Hoskote. But, you know, they come here every month when we do this series, but they're hoping to learn something from it. It's a particular mindset. When we do work, and this is in a panel discussion format, a workshop format is a little more hands-on, a little more in-depth, a little more committed. You know, again, whether it's a free or a paid, it gives you another consumer. And consumption, I think, varies at different points. I think, you know, on an optimistic note, I feel Bombay at the moment is quite exciting. I mean, there are so many people looking to do so many things. I mean, this is a decent crowd, but we have, you know, with one emailer, depending on the time of day and what else is happening in the city, we have so many people coming. And, you know, people are poor, time poor, you know, they have multiple options to do. So to actually take that commitment out, your family, of distances, Bombay is not an easy city to get around. It takes a mindset, and people are willing. There's a whole young audience, and you know, especially, you know, from college students and stuff, who we attract, especially at Kala Ghoda. I mean, I'm always amazed. I know when we used to do our writing workshops at Kala Ghoda, we used to do multiple in a day. We used to have these people who used to come come from far off places. And they said, we're spending the day out here. I said, seriously? I said, yeah. I said, do you know what the next workshop is? He said, no, but they just wanted to sit and experience all of them, which is another mindset by itself. So yeah, the consumption patterns are increasing.
I'm going to put the same question to you, but with the awareness that your practice is another kind of wager on who this audience or recipient or participatory audience might be. So again, would you map that in a certain way? Do you accumulate research on, and this ties into that question which you didn't answer, on what is your archival memory from within the project of the audience?
In fact, we're just currently, what is ongoing is the 7th edition of this Encounters Festival, where last year, in fact, the project looked at the idea of mobility, and we were given this blanket permission by VT Station, and we found that what was happening there with all the works in one space was we were gaining a lot of research in terms of where, what the outcome of these interactions were. So this year we said, let's look at the site more specifically of VT and see if we can turn this space that is really reflective of the social or cultural fabric of the city, whether we can turn this through the works into a kind of incubator of ideas. And so in the first week of the interventions there was one piece which was a radio broadcast that the artist had activated by hijacking the frequencies there, yeah. And there was another piece by an Indian artist, Teja Gavankar, who had these, basically they were just simple dots, and she was inviting people to join these dots but not form a square. And the multiple forms that she was then gathering, she was turning into this kind of archive. So on one hand, so I started asking people randomly, what was the experience of the different works that they had encountered there. And one of the guys said, that work, he was referring to the radio, he said, that piece took me to the past, because he's reminding me of a form of communication that we don't use anymore. And this piece is taking me to the future, because for him it felt that he was inventing something. Even if it was a really simple, ridiculous form, maybe, yeah. So that is one way of archiving the experience. The second is the numbers who are actually participating. In the case of the project that I had mentioned, Kyung Woo, his process is he has a number. 400 people means 400 people, no matter how tough it is to get those people to actually become a part of the work. In other cases, it depends really. We try to use more marketing tactics. So who are the people who are actively engaged? Who are the people, the numbers of people who ask questions? Then maybe having a little survey, where the assistant will ask questions on how people experience the work. So that way, we're trying to understand whether people are really understanding the work. So what is the work really activating? Is it really activating anything? And that's how we map it. Then we also try to engage different kinds of audiences. So an audience that you would get maybe at a beach, you wouldn't get at a gallery setting or at a symposium. So we do, the process is that the works that are realized outside, we do also place it in a gallery setting and then seeing what is the conversation between these two spaces. And we also have seminars, and so we're collaborating with Avid on the next one. So that is also a way to engage really different kinds of audiences and NGOs and the usual stuff.
No, I was just about to make a plug for the Avid seminar, Art Oxygen.
This is getting very meta.
It's very incestuous, this whole system. It's on the 26th. Please come. It's going to be really cool.
Yeah. But this might be the moment to ask questions. Yeah. Do we have a mic that can travel?
My name is Anand. Thanks for this. So my question is about that one of those photographs in the Art Oxygen series, was the word for it. You had food at VT on a table, on a couple of tables lined up, you know, different. So I'm curious, there were katoris of food and just lying there, nobody.
That wasn't VT, was it? The table?
That was in Korea.
Oh, Korea.
But anyways.
Okay. I thought, well, I'm curious if how long it took for people to just drop in and finish it off, and would that change the focus or the flow of your experiment?
It was food, it was?
There was a white table, white cloth covered series of tables, some chairs, and just food in bowls.
After that showed people feeding
each other. Yeah.
Okay. That was a performance actually, another one by the same Korean artist. That was done in Goa, in fact, and it was part of this this three-part series on food that the artist was studying.
Gotcha.
Where the first part was where he got people to create their own recipes of this typical Korean food called bibimbap, something like that.
Bibimbap.
The second one, which is what we did in Goa, was so we invite people who don't know each other to sit at a table and feed each other.
Oh.
And what are what happens in this space of 30 minutes? Where so we divide the people into side A and side B, and side A starts to feed side B, but you're not allowed to speak to the other person. So you feed them what you think the person would want to eat, and your combination of food you select according to what you imagine that person would like to eat. So it becomes something extremely intimate because you're sharing something that is related to nurturing, to caring with somebody you don't know. And this is another element of vulnerability that this artist plays on with all of his works.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, first and foremost, I would like to congratulate you all for the efforts that you all have put onto this. Okay, and my question is to Leandra. See, you are doing a lot many experiment basically with going out, taking art in the outdoor scenario. I've been hearing means that you are having several issues getting permissions and some challenges that you are being facing at various stages. And you have been doing this all over India, you say, South Korea, you say. Okay, now when you initiate a project like this, you might be doing some homework, I would say, like some indoor practices. So you would also be keeping in mind whatever the challenges that you might be facing outside. So in case whatever you have planned, if that doesn't go through it, like you have this picture of that some Thane, wherein you were mapping something and that was in your schedule that you would need to cover that particular area, which eventually the situation turned hostile and you had to stop it. So did you have any backup plan for that, or was it like shut means shut?
No, in that case, we stopped the work.
Okay.
And at first we were, I mean, for us, it was the first time that a work got so confrontational, and we had just started this practice. It was the second Encounters festival. But I think in the long run, we were always questioning whether our approach should have been different. But then the artist had visited the slum area. She had met with them, and she wanted them to get engaged with the mapping exercise. So she wanted them to take part in the work, and so we questioned whether this piece was actually successful or was it a failure. And I think it's because we're looking at how people react to a piece. I think in that sense, you're really shifting the positioning, and you're also showing how volatile this space is, the public space, because we have no control anymore. And the challenges of permissions, how people will receive a work, how they'll experience it, we never know. And it's all very much part of the practice, and failure is also very much part of the practice. So, yeah.
One last question. Oh, that was the last question.
Just one comment in with reference to building new audiences. While building and growing may just seem like two words on the surface, but building an audience is more about taking an audience and stacking it up, whether it is for numbers or whether it is for visibility or whether it is for the reach. But for growing an audience, I think the strategy would be completely different. So do think about that aspect also, that you could organically also let it grow so that it grows.
Sure, but it has to be a dual approach.
Yes, it has to be. Yeah. It has to be. But I think one can look at both of them as sure. a strategy.
So you have come across many audiences in past. Oh, wow. How is it today's audience just now?
Leandro, I think it's for you. It's very public. Wonderful.
Always wonderful. But I'm going to actually use the last 2 minutes to do something which I do very rarely. Sudhir, I'm looking directly at you. Only because we have your eminence in the room. And I've often thought of what a great benchmark it was, your Vistarnari Kshitije, Expanding Horizons. Because that was based on a very particular leap of faith. Your sense that there was an audience across the state of Maharashtra, which for all kinds of reasons of location or institutional deficits did not have access to the modern and the contemporary. And then you took this traveling exhibition across. So I think, you know, in the interests of this audience, could I invite you to maybe reflect a little bit on what prompted that and how it went in the context of the kinds of issues we've been talking about? Also in terms of what sort of wager do you place on this indefinite audience?
I think the first thing was the faith in what we were planning to take out, and that was the art, that was modern and contemporary art. And one believed that this had something to say to people whom it had not reached yet. But it did have something to say to these people. I'm saying this specifically because there is a shift in contemporary art which thinks that art no longer has something to say, and therefore new kind of art needs to be put out to speak to these people. So this was a faith in the art that was already there. That is point number one. The second thing was the faith in the audience, in the sense one knew, it was not just a faith, I think one knew that there was a need for this, for the audience out there. They were looking for it, they were reading about it, they were reading about it in the media. Many of them were actually students who had come to art colleges, gone to art colleges, but had lost contact with what was happening in the subsequent decades and things like that. So that was one section of the audience. The second section of the audience were writers, poets, literary people who had always been in contact and knew about modernism, postmodernism, everything, but did not have access to the visual arts, because that does not travel just in ways books travel. So there was a clear disconnect between disconnect in the sense there's a kind of gap between need and supply, or need and, you know. So that, I think it came from that essentially, and that if one of the questions that came to mind when Leander was presenting many of these works was that, and I think you touched upon that, Ranjit, that what really was this audience at VT left with? Did it really make a difference to their life? Did it really make a difference, not to their life, but to their thinking in any sense? And I think this connects with what Anupam also said, that the growth, that belief that an audience needs to be nurtured, and it's not like a point intervention that happens. That seems more like a growth of the artist, or rather his career, rather than a growth directed towards audiences. An audience needs to be nurtured in a sustained way, and, you know, I don't know, I mean, I'm saying things that are coming to mind.
From that nurturing part, I mean, I agree, and I've not brought in a lot of the Avid examples, but at Avid, you know, we do these workshops, we start with 101s and then we go to 2.0s. We'll do a talk, a basic talk like this, or we did one on archiving, Anupam was there. And then we did a whole workshop on archiving, you know, to actually have this trajectory of growth for the audience. We'll do a basic creative writing, and then after creative writing, you do an advanced creative writing. So we have curated, we plan when we do this. You know, I agree, you have to nurture the audience. They rely on you for that. And then you give them options where, and then you give them options of something new. So yeah, 100%
yes,
agree on that.
I know, I mean, Avid has definitely been working in that direction. And there is a change now, I think, with the availability of the media and things like that, that has grown. And therefore, one really does not need to go out physically in the same way as one thought it was necessary at one point. And therefore, now, to make yourself available for audiences to come to you, you know? And your programming and things like that help a lot in that direction, surely, yeah.
To add to what you were saying, yes, on one, now. What I showed was, what we saw was a lot of interventions that happened for a temporary period of time. On one hand, yes, we're looking at the artist. We're looking also at the public work, and we're also questioning what a public work of art might be. And we're questioning the opposite of temporary. Because we're saying that it doesn't need to be permanent. We're saying that values are changing, people change, their beliefs change, and so also the work of art and these different kinds of experiences that are generated from it. And we also, the works and the artists do different kinds of works. They might be interventions, they might be just sculptural installations. They're also community projects, which means that you are working with a group of people for a sustained period of time, whether it's a month, 2 months, some years, and how this translates into different kinds of works. Now, in one of the projects, it was Sharmila Saman's work, where she had done these, she was tracking water resources under the ground, and she wanted to, because she was working for a long time in this area in Mangkur, in one of the villages, and they didn't have any bore well. So this is one example where the artist has a sustained long-term relationship with a group of people, and then they do different interventions together that are artistic, but also sometimes lead to something more. But if we could, we would have interventions every week in the city, but also relationships in terms of the different kinds of people we have to negotiate with. So whether it is officials or I know, different kinds of people at the site, shopkeepers, people who use or work there, and even if it's for a temporary time, I know we think it's quite significant, both for the artist and maybe also, I think also for the people who engage with the work. In fact, some of the artists are sitting here, so maybe you might want to add to this.
My name is Parag, Parag Tandil. I was part of Art Oxygen's first encounter. So Recently, last year I finished one public art project in Mines, which is in Turbhai, near Navi Mumbai. So I worked for just whole 1 year. And somewhere I felt I'm not reaching there, because I'm just talking on surface, because you don't know what I did there. So I'm just telling you the experience I went through. It was like I was acting for 1 year was not sufficient. I thought, why not work for 12 years there on same site? So this is the second year we are working there, and the title of the project is Wreckage Point 12. So they are mining a lot of stone from Parsik Hills, and we are working with children. We are going to document that site for 12 years, and we are documenting through children. It means a lot. It's not just a photography. There is sound. There are many things there. So I'm sorry, but it is like many artists are collaborating. Then geologists are there. Then aeronautic engineers are there for this year. So we are just changing and trying to develop hypothesis kind of thing. And I really feel let's see that this year what happens. And after this year, what I can experience it. Am I reaching there, or what I am doing? I'm just testing myself. You just can't collect crowd and all. This is very different. It's experiential thing. It's really experiential. Who is working on site and who is into the project? This is very much important for me. So that's all I can say.
Thanks. Thank you, Parag. Okay, and that will actually be the last question.
Yeah, I think just to continue on what Sudhir was saying, do we know what, for example, one of the public works that were displayed at VT station, what the audience that was encountering it, what did they think they were encountering? I'm just curious to understand whether they thought they were encountering art, an experiment, a social experiment. Is it all the same? Of course, it could all be the same, but what did they think, or what was their perception of what they were experiencing? Or did they think this is just a bunch of kooky people doing something, and hey, let me just throw something in there and see what happens?
There were different kinds of experiences from the different works that were there. In the second week, there was Oweso Sen's work, where he places these trunks. This is huge mountain of trunks, and on which there's a video that is flashing onto the trunks. The video is talking about migration and movement and how we lose part of ourselves when we move to the city. Blah blah blah. In the morning, so we install in the night, and in the morning you get your first commuters at 6 o'clock. People actually asked us whether this was a new kind of way of security, yeah, because there was a lot of heightened security at that space. And then you start talking to them, you talk about the work, then they watch the work, and then they will tell you what they think of it, or you know, what is the point of it even. So that is one kind of reaction. Then there was Emilio's work, which was, he's sitting at the back. It's a carpet piece, which has, which shows a ticket. It's a train ticket and inside the ticket, there are two footprints, which says you are here. And again, people ask whether this was related to new security at the station, or people are watching us, and they were very excited that they're being watched, and you know, it's becoming a safe place. And then again, you explain the work, and then there was also Pradeep Mishra's work, which was a kind of trolley, a goods trolley, that is covered in jute, and inside he wraps roses, and then he has a lotus pond, and then inside there fish. So the lotus is growing and dying and growing and dying as the day goes by, and people start to pray there. They start to pray there, some take pictures, some take selfies. So there are different ways that people are reacting to the work. Then with the radio broadcast, in fact, the artist had one situation where somebody picked up, so he kept the broadcast was both live as well as pre-recorded, and the pre-recorded session was these interviews, so random interviews where he meets people at the station and asks them what colors they like at the station, why are they there, why are they using it, trying to activate this this understanding also of ourselves, of why we're using spaces, how we're using them, what we like, what we don't like in them. So very simply. And so the broadcast had these pre-recorded interviews, which is one kind of engaging with people, and then a live session. And during the live session, one guy comes and picks up the mic and starts talking very heatedly about India and Pakistan, and so very rhetoric. And the artist didn't know whether he had the power to stop it or whether he should just let this continue. And this is also one of the really critical questions of what is happening really to the work and to the artist in this space, and the audience also, when we're providing a space and how it is activated in very different ways. Hope I answered your question.
Well, let me thank Asad and Leandre, both of you, for the candor, actually, that you brought to your accounts of your practices. And I do also want to thank the audience for this very full-bodied, robust engagement, and many things to take away from you. I mean, the keywords and key phrases that came from what I'm not going to call the floor, but the difference between building and growing an audience that you raised, Anupam. So your caveat about whether the expanded studio does more for a new self-understanding of artistic practice than the audience, or whether one can have some kind of wager on the audience. And I think that really prompted a whole series of reflections. So thank you all, and I'm now going to ask Urshila to do the actual formal vote of thanks.
Thank you to our panel for giving us so many concepts and so many more questions to mull over. And of course, that was reflected in as Ranjit said, in our wonderful audience participation. I want to thank Ranjit especially for so beautifully and capably facilitating our entire Beyond Contemporary Art series. And we would also like to thank the Max Müller Bhavan and the Goethe Institute for hosting us throughout the series. We have a number of art events coming up, which the first and foremost, which include Leander's art symposium, which we will have at the ICIA just across the road. So do pick up flyers, and remember, learning never stops. Have a wonderful evening.